This is a copyrighted work. Unauthorized copying or distribution is a crime punishable by up to 5 years in prison and a fine of $250,000.
Scholastic Audio presents Piggy, Hunt, an original novel by Terrance Crawford and Dan Widdowson, read by Fred Berman. Chapter 1. There had once been an island called Lucella. Far past Doveport, and somewhere south of the North Sea, its outer edges were sprinkled with long beaches and stretches of picturesque mountains that led to a salting of dense forests. In the middle of the island was a city, a sprawling metropolis bustling with life. On a normal day, thousands of people went about their daily lives, searching for the perfect avocado at the grocery store or reading the paper on the metro to work. On a normal day, crossing guards waved children across the street to school, and neighbors greeted one another cheerily as they passed one another on the streets. On a normal day, the sun hung low over the island, casting a lazy glow across the city. The island of Lucella had not had a normal day in quite some time. If you were to ask those who were in the know, they would tell you that it had started off just like any other sickness. They would tell you that one day your neighbor would have a sniffle, or that your friend would have a cough that didn't sound quite right. By the time the fever started, it was too late. The people of Lucella were going to sleep and waking up as something not quite themselves. Their eyes were beginning to glow. Their walks stiffened to a lumbering gait, and they were beginning to smell like the worst part of a hot summer day. Whatever the sickness was, it had turned normal, everyday people into grisly, gruesome, ghoulish shadows of their former selves. "Hold it down!" Ben shouted as loudly as he could muster, struggling to be heard over the loud, unpleasant, and prolonged sounds the infected creature was making. The thing thrashed wildly in Ben's grasp, squealing loudly as it tried to break free. It may not have looked like it, fist balled tightly around the creature's tattered shirt, and a cure-loaded quick-release syringe poised to go in his outstretched hand, but Ben was trying to help. The creature wriggled its body once more, this time its haphazard movements accompanied by a terrifying scream. Ben held the creature in place as best he could, but coming in direct contact with the teeth or claws of the infected was as good as asking for the infection. Ben narrowly dodged a swipe from the massive creature's untrimmed cloven hoof. The syringe holding the cure was not lucky enough to share that same fate. The creature knocked the vial out of Ben's hand, and Ben's eyes followed it as it twisted in the air end over end before finally landing in the grass a few yards from where the two sat. The creature noticed as well, taking advantage of the momentary chaos and confusion to roughly tackle Ben to the ground. The two opposing forces tussled some more in the dirt, neither gaining the upper hand for longer than a couple of moments. In any given person's life, there are three, maybe four moments that cause one to truly stop and reflect on the choices that led them to said moment. Rolling around in the dirt, trying to restrain something nearly twice his size so that he could administer a glowing blue cure created by the military in a super-secret lab up north, was the first of those moments in Ben's young life. These past several months had been both long and eventful, to say the least. Ben remembered how things used to be. He remembered when he would count down the days until summer vacation. 3 whole months of no school, no bedtime, and all the online survival horror-based video games that he could handle. This summer, Ben was simply grateful for the few extra hours of sunlight, keeping at bay the sea of glowing red eyes that seemed to follow him and his friends wherever they went. It had been a crisp autumn day when Ben had left his home, not knowing then that he was taking the first steps in what would become the adventure of a lifetime. Back then, the dense, nearly solid layer of fog that enshrouded the city seemed almost seasonally appropriate before it had become a seemingly permanent fixture of the landscape of Lucella. Now, with Ben spending each day out in the elements, every day was either too hot or too cold. On the days that the sun managed to fight its way through the haze of cloud cover, Ben found it entirely too hot, salt constantly stinging his eyes as he wiped sweat from his brow. Most days, however, Ben and his friends were at the mercy of the almost supernatural chill that hung in the air over the island, no matter the actual temperature. Seasons had come and gone, days turning into weeks and weeks turning into months, but the chill lingered. It was little to no wonder that Ben still clung so preciously to the hooded black leather jacket he had been wearing since the beginning of this adventure. Of course, the elements were not the only thing from which Ben was seeking protection. Ben had been aware of the infection from the beginning. At first, even if no one you knew had caught it, it was impossible to escape the specter that the news cast over Lucella. The hushed whispers on street corners, the 3-minute bits on the early evening news, the news ticker that scrolled by beneath every television program. Awareness was all well and good, but nothing prepared you for seeing one of the things up close and in person. The first time Ben had seen one of the creatures was at the home of his best friend, Ollie. One may not have been able to figure it out by looking at him, but the young man currently pinned to the ground by a quarter of a ton of breathing abomination had not set out to be some kind of post-apocalyptic war hero. Before this had all begun, before the cure vials, before the police station, and long before the giant killer spiders, Ben had been on a simple mission to find his friend. That one objective had been the driving force behind everything that had happened to Ben over the last several months. Of course, Ollie was not to blame. It was hard enough to let your friends and family know where to find you these days, even more so if you weren't certain if there was anyone around to look for you. To his credit, in the time that Ben had been looking for his lost friend, Ollie had become quite adept at looking out for himself. All that time surviving alone among the elements had hardened his exterior, if not his personality. If Ben had to take a guess, he would have wagered that Ollie had more experience fighting off the infected than even Ben, and at this point, that was no small feat. Ben had been up against more than his fair share of the things. He shuddered as he remembered the mysterious Mr. P, a disembodied voice who seemed to exist only on the other side of his walkie-talkie. Ben had been flipping through the channels on his walkie-talkie one evening when he had heard the man's pleas for help. Ben had rescued the man's missing friend, Bunny, and she in turn had rescued him. Ben had heard rumors floating around the safe place that Mr. P was a millionaire or that he owned a helicopter. But the truth was, no one knew for sure. Ben and Ollie's eventual reunion had been interrupted by the arrival of a swarm of the infected, not surprising to absolutely anyone who possessed the ability to recognize patterns. The duo had been pinned against a wall, trapped by a sea of glowing red eyes. What had once been a terrifying harbinger of doom was now an all too familiar everyday sight. The only thing that had saved Ben's and Ollie's respective skins from the bloodthirsty crowd of ghouls had been the timely and somewhat dramatic arrival of Billy and Badgie, agents of the Silver Paw. As it turned out, Ben and Ollie weren't the only survivors. Dozens of people had banded together under the leadership of a wolf named Willow and formed a militia of sorts based at the safe place. Billy was a gentle giant, a massive bull who was also the friendliest person Ben had ever met. Everything a person could ever want to know about Billy could be explained by the weapon he had chosen to wield against the end of the world, a stainless steel barbell with a pair of weighted plates on either side. Badgie was a badger, and Billy's constant companion. If he thought about it, Ben wasn't sure if he had ever seen the two apart. Although Badgie was admittedly not as friendly as Billy, Ben liked to think that he had peeled back Badgie's gruff exterior and gotten to know his prickly, gruff interior as the quartet had journeyed to and from, and then back to, the safe place. The safe place, the most aptly named point on the island, was a 5-story building in the heart of the city of Lucella. The exterior was cold and gray, projecting a facade so seemingly impenetrable that you would never know that just beyond the thrice-bolted double doors lie 5 storage rooms, a laundry room, a gym, a cafeteria, a main room, a radio room, and enough bedrooms to accommodate the displaced of Lucella. Ben had not spent as much time as he would have liked at the safe place. He had barely had enough time to verify that his parents were safe and accounted for before he was being hustled into a single room in the basement, whiteboards and computers spread across every inch of available wall space. Willow had a mission for him, and she did not seem like the type of wolf to take no for an answer. There were rumors, whispered on the wind from survivors from across the island, that there was a way to fix the people who had been turned wild by the infection. They were calling it a cure. Less than 24 hours after Willow had received the intel, Ben and Ollie had been dispatched to go investigate, Billy and Badgie in tow. It was a journey that had taken them from the once bustling metropolis of the city of Lucella to the massive tree-laden forests just outside town, the quartet picking up components of the purported cure everywhere they went. Their journey eventually brought them to a place called Doveport, a city across the North Sea. According to the research journals from the old military base, this is where the traveling group of adventurers would find the final components of the cure. Lucella boasted a slight chill in the air and a seemingly never-ending supply of fog that had accompanied the arrival of the virus, but it was still better than the nearly solid sheet of snow that blanketed Doveport at all times. Both were probably results of weather patterns from being so close to the North Sea, but only one managed to soak through Ben's jacket and chill him to the bone. What the group had thought to be the final piece of the cure was hidden deep underground, stashed away deep in the cavernous tunnels that snaked beneath the massive stone temple in Doveport. Of course, true to form, that was not the only thing that lay beneath the temple. Ben and his companions had to dodge giant axes swinging from the ceiling and solve a series of wheel puzzles to gain access to the underground passageways, and they still had not faced the deadliest part of their journey. That came in the form of a creature called Spidella, a hulking and heavily built infected creature with 8 legs and no compunctions about trapping her hapless victims in her web and doing what giant spiders were wont to do. Ben had seen some incredible, horrible things since the infection had come to settle in Lucella, but all of them paled in comparison to Spidella. Twice Ben's size and at least as heavy, Spidella was a nightmare creature with 8 elephantine legs, 4 beady black eyes, and small needle-like hairs all over her massive abdomen. Navigating the labyrinthine tunnels beneath the temple had been scary enough, to say nothing of being pursued by a giant spider. Ben and his companions had found the final ingredient of the cure, and not a moment too soon. Ollie had fallen prey to one of Spidella's webs, and the infection was already beginning to spread. It was thanks only to the labs beneath the temple, Ben's quick acting, and the radioactive tubing that Badgie had been using as a weapon that they were able to fashion a rudimentary version of the cure and save Ollie from the same grisly fate that had befallen much of his hometown. Ben was relieved to discover that he found the journey up through the caverns much simpler than the journey down, having been largely relieved of the pressure of being chased by an 8-legged monster. Lucky for the fearless adventurers, they reached the docks of Doveport without any further incidents with the infected. Billy was more than strong enough to push an unclaimed boat from the north docks into the sea with everyone aboard, and it turned out that Badgie was even a half-decent navigator when he wasn't murmuring angrily under his breath about the weather. Ollie had started feeling better almost immediately. The cure.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.